Exodus chapter 24, verse 17. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on the top of the mountain. The earth is yours, and everything in it, most precious God. Glory be to your name, who may ascend the mountains of the Lord. Clean our heart, O Lord, let your
your name. Glory, glory. outside the United States of America. Blessed be your holy name in Jesus' name.
Amen.
This morning we pray, speak to us.
Amen.
Encourage those who are discouraged.
Amen.
Clear confusion.
Amen.
Embolden those who are fearful.
Amen.
Forgive those who have sinned.
Amen.
Heal those who are sick.
Amen.
And let your name be glorified.
Amen.
Blessed be your holy name.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name we are praying.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Briefly today, we'll be considering what I've titled the integrity of God's word.
Amen.
The integrity of God's word.
Amen.
Seriously speaking, since we don't have children here, practically everybody here will have known that. Living in this world is not McDonald's. It's not. In the part of Africa where I came from, I can say living in this world is not Mr. Biggs. That's another popular food. or tantalize, thank you so much. Yes. To have grown to this age, you will have experiences.
Yes, sir.
That shows you that living in this world is not from fear. It's not from fear at all. And if that is the case, then we need to be assured of what we are living with.
Amen.
We'll take our text from the book of Isaiah 55. Isaiah 55. So I read from verse 8. For my thoughts, Isaiah 55 from verse 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and pour, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it.
Amen.
So we are considering the integrity of God's word today. You see, the word integrity actually means remaining the same under different circumstances.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Under different circumstances.
Yes, sir.
When we say somebody has integrity, the person remains the same under different circumstances. When he has money, he doesn't steal. When he doesn't have money, he doesn't steal.
Yes.
When he promises to marry a girl, and the girl is around, he does not follow other girls. And when the girl goes to another state, to school, and he is alone, it still doesn't go after other girls.
Yes,
so we say, the word integrity means to stay the same under different circumstances, doing the right thing.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We shall address three questions today. Number one, why considering the integrity of God's word? Why do we want to consider that? Why is it important to consider the character of God's word? That's point number one we are going to consider. Point number two is we are going to consider the packaging of God's word. The packaging of God's word. In other words, what has happened to God's word for it to have generated such integrity, the packaging, what has happened? And then the third point, we'll consider the cloud of witnesses. That is, why should I put my life out on the word of God? Has somebody done it before? That's why it's subtitled as cloud of witnesses.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Point number one, why should we consider the integrity of God's word? We are considering the integrity of God's word for two reasons. Number one reason is that a Christian has to deal with God. That's number one.
Yes.
Number two, under that point, number one is that a Christian has to deal with the devil.
Yes.
Now, we need to consider the integrity of God's word because we need to deal with God. Because we need to do what? Deal with God. And the reason is that nobody has seen God before. You will agree with me that it's easier.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you see somebody and you discuss, that might be part of what we are facing today, why receiving something from God seems to be more difficult than when Jesus walked on the surface of the earth. You know, they saw him. Somebody could see him. I've heard about his miracle, his passing on. Jesus Christ, the son of David, have mercy on me. They saw him. Everybody who received miracle from Jesus while he was walking on this earth was not born again. Everybody. So you begin to wonder, those people were not born again. We are born again. Why does it seem difficult? Because the way we are living in this world is like we are constructed to be adapted more easily to the things that we see. And we are dealing with a God that we do not see. Many of us here and those watching online have been born again 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. Nobody can categorically say that you have seen God physically. And you have to deal with him. And this God, in the book of John chapter 1 and verse 18, the Bible says nobody has seen God except the only begotten Son who was in his bosom is the one that has revealed him. John chapter 1 and verse 18. John chapter 1 and verse 18. Nobody has seen God. That statement was uttered by Jesus Christ. Till today, nobody has seen Jesus. In fact, some people have become atheists because of what we are talking about now. They've tried to subject God to scientific model. To scientific model. And it doesn't work. Because model, any particular model, any scientific model, either climate change model or any model in public health, are built up upon certain assumptions. They fit the model with assumptions. I'm sure many of us have heard the Governor Cuomo, Andrew Cuomo of New York, saying that they are working on model that will tell them, okay, at so particular time, this is the number that is likely to come. He said, but these models are changing. Why? Because when you are dealing with a virus that has, you know, different strains and people are reacting differently,
right,
there will be changing complexities. And the scientists will have to sit down to change the model again to fit in another set of variables to be able to get an answer. That's how scientific model or any model works. So a particular model does not work for all things. So when you subject God to a model, and it's a variable far from the reach of science, you will get an answer, but the answer will be wrong. So since they get a particular answer, now if you go into public health, you get some variable, like quantitative variable, and you subject it to a model that answers to qualitative variable, the computer will give you an answer. You may be happy, but the answer is wrong because you have missed part of the assumption. So some people become atheists because of that. They say, okay, if you cannot do this, this, we can't touch him, he doesn't exist. Because we need to deal with a God who is not visible. You need to understand the integrity of his word. Secondly, it said, in the beginning was the word. John chapter 1 and verse 1. And the word was God. That means, as I'm talking to you now, the closest you can get to God is his word. And the Lord revealed himself to Samuel by his word.
Amen.
By his word.
Amen.
Now, if you have to deal with a God that you do not see, and he has spoken to you that the closest you can come is my word, you need to sit down with the word to understand it. is the one that say, okay, without faith you cannot please God, and you cannot develop faith
without
the word. For the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what?
By the word of God.
That second hearing means understanding. That is, faith comes by hearing and understanding of God's word. See, that Enoch had gone to Jerusalem, he did the ceremony and all of that, and was going back and was reading scripture, and he didn't understand it. Evangelist Philip moved in and understanded that what thou readest. He was reading, he was hearing, but the understanding was not there, and he would not be saved because the understanding was not there.
Yes, sir.
But as soon as he was explained to and he understood the word, faith comes alive, he was born again and he got baptized. So faith comes by understanding, not by quoting the scripture, by understanding what we are reading. Now, see the spiritual equation now. Here is God who say, I am my word. Go to my word. You cannot please me unless you have faith. And the faith comes from word. So you have to pay attention to the word. Because when you want to ask anything from God, you want to get anything from God, you come closest to him by his word. So if you do not understand that his word has integrity, and you speak it, God, I need healing, and you are still feeling the symptom the following day, you will think God has lied to you. This is the reason why we are considering this.
Yes,
I have said two points.
Yeah.
Under that point number one, we are dealing, the reason why we are considering the integrity of God is you have to deal with a God that you don't see.
Yes.
You have to deal with God that you do not see. Point number two, under that big number one, is because we have to deal with the devil. In other words, we are living in a conflict zone. Heaven is not a conflict zone.
Mm-mm.
Because the devil is not there.
Mm-mm.
Nobody, there is no conflict.
Mm-mm.
In fact, hell is not a conflict zone.
Mm-mm.
It is the domain of the devil. Anybody who goes there, you are finished everything. There is no point praying again.
Mm-mm.
But here, on the earth, it's a conflict zone. This is a watershed. This is what a watershed. I'm going to show you from the scripture why this place is a watershed. Because there's an example given of the heart that happened in the Bible. Let's go to the book of Isaiah chapter 36. Isaiah chapter 36. We are considering why we need to understand the integrity of God's word. One, because we are dealing with God. Secondly, because we are dealing with the devil. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, 36. We read from 12. But Rabshakeh said, and my master sent me to the master, to thy master, and told him to speak these words. Now, the background was that King Sennacherib was coming to Judah. And he had track record. Not him alone, his great grandfathers, they've been winning wars. Any nation they go to, they crushed.
Mm-hmm.
Not only have they been crushing like them, they've crushed Samaria.
Mm-hmm.
And not only have they crushed Samaria, they've crushed some town in Judah, the southern kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
So this guy has track record of victories.
Yes.
This time around, they are coming upon the city of Jerusalem itself. And then the errand boy of King Sennacherib said, had my master, that's verse 12 now, Isaiah chapter 36, had my master sent me to thy master and to thee to speak these words, had he not sent me to the men that sat upon the wall, that they may eat their own dung and drink their own pill with you? Then Rabshakeh stood and cried with a loud voice in the Hebrew language. I want you to be paying attention to people that sat on the wall. That's what I want us to pay attention to. And how this guy cried in the Hebrew language. Understand that he's not an Hebrew guy. He just understood the language. And he was speaking with maybe Syrian language or whatever their own language is to the leaders of the people before. And when they say, oh, please speak gently, just speak to us. Ah, no, I must speak to everybody. So he began to speak to the soldiers on the wall who only understood Hebrew language. Okay? So he said, verse 13, and said, had hear ye the word of the great king, the king of Assyria. Thus saith the king. Most of the time in the Bible, you hear, thus saith the Lord. For you to hear, thus saith the king.
Okay.
This guy is putting himself on the same
level,
on the same level with God. Okay, he said, thus saith the king, let not Hezekiah deceive you, for he shall not be able to deliver you. Neither let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord, saying, the Lord will surely deliver us. This city shall not be delivered. This city shall not be delivered into the hand of the king of Assyria. Hearken not to Hezekiah, for thus saith the king of Assyria, make an agreement with me by a present, and come out to me, and eat ye every one of his vine, and every one of his fig tree, and drink ye every one the waters of his own cistern, until I come and take you away to a land like your own land, a land of corn and wine, a land of bread and vineyard. Behold, let Hezekiah persuade you, saying, the Lord will deliver us. Had any of the gods of the nation delivered his land out of the hand of the king of Assyria? Where are the gods of Hamath and Arphad? Where are the gods of Sepharvaim? And have they delivered Samaria out of my hand? Who are they among all the gods of this land that have delivered their land out of my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem out of my hand? But they held their peace and answered him not a word, for the king's commandment was, answer him not.
Amen.
Now, the Bible said that the people, that guy was speaking, they were sitting down on the wall. That looks to me like people are sitting down on the fence.
Yeah.
In English language, when you say somebody is sitting on the fence, what's the meaning?
It's
open to two opinions equally.
Right.
Is that not so? Now, these people, King Hezekiah, when he heard that Sennacherib was coming, he went to the how do we, what's the proper term now, brother? And he went to the soldier, how do you call group of people?
Battalion.
Eh?
Battalion.
Battalion. So he went to battalion, just like President Trump can go to battalion. And that's very okay, because when you see your leader come to you, you feel important, isn't it? So King Hezekiah went to them and said, please, I want you to know that the Lord is with us, that the Lord will keep us, that the Lord will protect us, the Lord will deliver this city. Please, sit down on the wall, and when this guy comes, don't answer him anything. That was the first word they had. Now, when the errand boy of the king of Assyria come, he began to say his own. He gave a download of so many nations that they have destroyed.
Yeah.
He gave reasons why they will be defeated too. Mm. So these guys were fit. I mean, they were fed with two different opinions.
Yeah.
That's conflict zone.
Yeah.
That's why I say this world is a conflict zone, even for Christians.
Yeah.
Because you continue to hear both sides.
Right.
You continue to hear both sides.
Yeah.
Now, if you are in a place of conflict and you are not sure of the integrity of the person that you have come to follow, you are likely going to fall flat.
Yes.
That is the reason why we are considering this. Many times, when we are praying, or certain things happen, the more elderly people in the faith will say, ah, the word of God has addressed this thing.
Yes.
I'm telling you.
Yes.
You say, oh, that one is in the Bible. Of course, we keep on having new Christians in the church, and we will have to necessarily raise certain things. But just like you will not come out when the pastor says, who wants to give his life to Jesus? Why? You are already assured of that.
Yes.
That's why you are not coming out again.
Yes.
But because we always have people, the pastor has to make the announcement.
Yes.
Practically every time. There are things that the pastor or the deacon will say that they don't apply to you again.
Mm-hmm.
You sorted them out ago. It's just because you are not assured and grounded in the world concerning that matter.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Because we are staying in a conflict zone. That is why we need to be assured of the character of God's word. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, against principality and power. Now, if you are wrestling, what does that suggest? Conflict zone.
Conflict
zone. I send you as a sheep among wolves. What does that suggest? Conflict soul. That's Matthew chapter 10 and verse 16. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. What is the meaning of that? Conflict soul.
But he
Psalm 34 and verse 16. Sending letter to the Thessalonican Christians, he said, I will have come unto you, but Satan hindered us. What is that? Conflict zone. And that is in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 18. These scriptures establish that living presently in this world, Jesus Christ said, the world you will have what? Tribulations, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. That's talking about conflict zone.
Hallelujah.
Now, if you have a God, you have to deal with by faith. And a ruthless enemy. Who will suggest so many things into your brain? You need to be assured of the war of God with whom you are standing. So that's why the Bible will say we stand by faith. You will never hear anywhere in the Bible where the Bible says we sit down by faith. Because a position of standing is a position of victory. It's the person who is defeated that that falls down. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Point number two, the packaging of God's word. That is, why should you believe God's word? Either to believe it, to receive something from God,
yes,
or to receive it, to deal with them. Why do we need to believe God's word? If we cannot see God, and we are in a conflict zone with the enemy, who is offering alternatives? Remember what we read in the book of Isaiah chapter 36? How that king was offering them alternatives. Say, I will take you to another land that looks like your own. That will look like maybe a single lady trusting God. God spoke 4 years ago. I said, okay, I'm going to give you a God-fearing man and all of that. 6 months into that promise, nothing happened. 1 year, nothing happened. 2nd year, nothing happened. 3rd year, nothing happened. Then suggestions begin to come. To our ear. This one too. Take this one. So he's not drinking. You can partner beat him with prayer. That is getting alternative now. So that is getting alternative. So when we are living in a world where you don't see God physically, to quickly run to him and say, sir, the equations are not balancing again. And then we have the devil represented by various theories and hypotheses and send individuals to you saying that you can also do it this way. Then we need to understand the word, how God packaged the word, so that your faith can be rooted and you'll be unmovable. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Number one, the word of God is pure. The meaning of purity is that it does not contain corruption. Psalm 12 and verse 6. The Bible says, the word of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in the furnace of the heart, purified 7 times. In other words, don't give it another meaning. Once you read it, let your mind stay on what it says. There's no word of God that is subjected to private interpretation. Stay with it. Because when the devil came to Adam and Eve, it was on the basis of God's word. It is in the process of re-examining the word that the red drug meaning to it. He said, has God said? You know, it was plain. So he's not asking them again, has God said? And when he came to Jesus, he said, if thou art the Son of God. You see, you can imagine Jesus going to, because Jesus himself said, I have come to fulfill thy will, O God, in the volume of the book. So there are things that were written. So if Jesus has gone to the scripture and said, am I really a Son of God? A son? Is it a son? Let us consider it very well. Let us reconsider it. By the time you finish, your feet are taught. When the Bible says, you are a son, and the word of God is pure, without any fraction of a lie, then you know it says what exactly it says and stand with it. So as the suggestions are coming, you are just pushing them away. You are just pushing them away. Praise the Lord. So the word of God is pure. Praise the Lord. Secondly, the word of God is unalterable. It can't be altered. Psalm 89 and verse 34, the Bible says, my covenant, pastor quoted that when we're praying, my covenant will I not break, nor alter the word that is gone out of my lay. So it's a doctrine. When you know when God speaks, it won't change. It grounds you. It puts your feet down and you are shaking. You know, God is not going to change that particular one. Number three, it is unveiling. Joshua chapter 21 and then verse 45. Joshua chapter 21 and verse 45. He said, none of the word that the Lord has given unto you fails. None of them. Not one word that God spoke to you of the good things that he said is going to perform fails. That was towards the end of the ministry of Joshua. Going to that, he was reminding the people of Israel. God said this, God said this, God said this. Now bring your diary out and begin to check one by one. None of them has failed. None of them has failed. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Point number four. Under that, it cannot be opposed. 2 Corinthians 13:8. We cannot do anything against the truth. But for the truth. When you know that the word that the Lord has spoken to you, nothing can come against it.
Amen.
If anything tries to come against it, it will eventually work in favor.
Amen.
Amen.
It will eventually work in favor of that word.
Amen.
So it cannot be opposed. So when you know the word of God is pure, it's unalterable, it's unfailing, and it cannot be opposed, your faith is grounded. Your faith is grounded. There is what I call 24 hours law of faith. 24 hours law of faith, which will happen to many of us because it happened to Jesus, and Jesus is the pattern son. Jesus just caused a fig tree at a particular time, and he left. And then the disciple left. Probably some of the disciples, they were looking back. Said, he caused that tree, and nothing happened. It seems as if nothing happened. The leaves were still dancing on the tree. The tree was not different from the rest of the tree that were around. They were all green. And then they left for Jerusalem from a nearby village. And then when they finished the ministry, they went back to that village in the evening. The tree was still there dancing, very green, isn't it?
Yes,
you know, nothing has happened and nobody took notice. The following morning, about 24 hours later, when they passed around that area, the tree was withered. Why? Sometimes when you pray, the evidence is still confronting you. The period of time is going to confront you is failure.
Yes.
Depending on what you are dealing with and the judgment of
God.
Sometimes it stays there. That 24 is in quote now. For Jesus, who spent 3 years ministering, and he has limited time. It was 24 hours. For some people, it might be 6 months. But if you are praying and nothing seems to change for 6 months, your feet may begin to shake. This is the reason why we are considering the integrity of God's word.
Yes.
So that you can stay. So that you can do what?
Stay.
In the year 2000, and, was it 2003? I read a book, I think I once mentioned it here. But my father and the Lord, Bishop Oyedepo, prevailing prayers. And when the fire was coming from the book, this book must not go alone. So I jotted everything from chapter 1 to the end of the things that ministered to me. After I was prepared with the word of Eva, when I was rising up from the study, I was like a rock, I'm telling you, nothing to shake. And he told me that what lies ahead of you, now I was an ass officer at that time, that it is not about giving birth to children, but your marital life is going to be windy. It is about the purpose of God over your life. You know, men know that you can just get out there now, get a girl along the road, and impregnate if it is just to give birth. Anybody can give birth. But when it comes to the plan and purpose for your life, there's a particular man that can help you to fulfill it. There's a particular woman that can help you to fulfill it.
Yes, right.
So I carried my book and Bible, and then I went to pray. I was going to a particular bush inside the University of Ibadan for 4 days. I think I once mentioned it. But this is where I'm going. God spoke to me the third day that the battle was over. Because I would just stay back. That you have revealed this to me, we have to do something about it.
Yes.
And God said the battle was over.
Amen.
That a woman that I got married to today said yes to me. From that 2003, it was 2008. What was for my own 24-hour law of faith for 5 years? So, if one doesn't know to wait on the integrity of God's word, you will miss it. So, once you know that the word of God is pure, unalterable, unfailing, and nothing can oppose it. Once you are sure, you will just stay there upon the integrity of God's word. Point number three, the cloud of witnesses. Because even in the science world, you know, before when things just started, as a scientific person, we depend on authorities, what we call authorities. That is, we come, we have some argument about certain evidence and say, okay, let's go to pastor. Since pastor is a theological authority, so pastor is okay, do it like this, do it like this. But as things move on, in the field of science, we began to deal with what we call evidence-based, whereby before you draw a conclusion about anything, you need to pull up literatures written by different people and see what percentage of people agree upon a particular truth. Say, oh, we have 250 authors concerning this subject, and then 200 of them agree upon this truth. It must be true. Because we have more people that agree upon that. That's what we call cloud of witness in the Bible. Cloud of witness. That is, before I stick my life out upon this world, has it happened to somebody before? What is the result of their life? Who can I check in the Bible that God spoke to and he didn't fail? Because Peter came to Jesus and said, okay, we have left all and we are following you. What shall be our gain? Jesus Christ said, I tell you, anybody who leave this and leave that people, hundredfold. Yeah. Peter didn't say, well, I'll just leave my fishing profession. What shall we
do?
Again.
Good.
Bishop Oyedepo said, now, I agree, I will preach. How will I feed my family? He spoke to God. God said, you go to Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. He caught that, even earlier before marriage, okay, and that was working for him. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and every other thing will be added unto you. So we need to look at the cloud of witnesses. Because of our time, I've limited it to one. But any interested person can look at the life of Joseph, look at the life of Abraham. These people received God's word, and at different times it came to pass. For one person it was 25 years. For another person it was like maybe 20 years or so. I think about 20 years for Joseph now. Like 20 years, God said he was going to be prime minister, which wasn't clear. That word wasn't used at that particular time. At 17, he became the governor. At 30, the siblings were going to proceed and all of that. You know, happened eventually after 22 years thereabout. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But in order to illustrate that God can speak to you, conflict will arise. And his word will still come to pass.
Yes.
We are going to use the life of Apostle Paul. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We are going to illustrate that. There was a time Paul was coming from one of his missionary journey. Every city he got to, practically every city he got to, somebody prophesied that problem awaited him in Jerusalem. I'm sure we remember that. As they were going, you know, moving towards Jerusalem, as they get to Caesarea, because by the time the church started, and the Gentiles were to be included in the church, it was like, you know, Caesarea just turned like a capital, sort of like Jerusalem, like a capital for Christianity to the Gentiles. Let me put it that way. So they enter Caesarea, where evangelist Philip was, and Agabus, a noted prophet, came and took a belt, tied his hand and leg, and said, this is what they will do to the owner of this belt as he got to Jerusalem. Similar prophecies have come before that time. And people were saying, oh, do not go. Paul said, no, I'm going. If they kill me in Jerusalem, let them kill me. And truly, when he got to Jerusalem, problem ensued. And he was arrested just like that. In the midst of that problem in Jerusalem, God showed up to Apostle Paul in the book of Acts chapter 23.
Amen.
God gave Apostle Paul a word. Acts 23 and verse 11. The Bible says, and the night following, after he had been arrested, they would have killed him, actually, but God saved him. In the night following, the Lord stood by him and said, be of good cheer, Paul, for as thou hast testified of me in Jerusalem, so must thou bear witness also at Rome.
Amen.
That was what God spoke to me. Much the same way God will have spoken something to us as individual. And most of the time when God speaks to us like that, what do? We are very happy. We take it, we are excited at that particular time. Mm-hmm. It's as things go by and we begin to face opposition that we tend to reconsider again. Did I hear God? That happens to everybody. Mm-hmm. Did I hear God? Did I not hear God? Mm-hmm. Am I sure again? Am I not sure again? Mm-hmm. So God spoke to Paul. You will get to Rome. This is Jerusalem where you are now. I'm sending you to Rome to preach. Do you know that as soon as God spoke that word, conflict began to arise? The first thing that we read about because of our time was in the same Act, chapter 23 and verse 12. More than 40 people bound themselves under a curse with fasting. You see, fasting is a very powerful spiritual mystery. Apart from Christianity, Islam, the Muslim, they fast every year. Mm-hmm. And that might be part of the reason why that religion is made. Constantly, they fast. And that is one that is general. There are other fastings in that religion that are not as popular. Let me put it that way. So these people band themselves and said, we are going to keep up. Let me ask you, if those people have succeeded, what happened to the word that Jesus gave to Paul? Mm-hmm. What will have happened to that word? That he was going to get to Rome. Do you know what the word of God? Because it is instructive to know that as soon as Jesus spoke here, he never showed up again until Paul got to Rome. Mm-hmm. He never showed up. Anybody who is interested can read from that Act 23 to the end. Jesus never showed up again. He left the world to be arranging every other thing. Remember, we read the other time in Isaiah chapter 55. Mm-hmm. He said, so shall my word be that is gone out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void. He shall accomplish that which I please and prosper in the thing whereunto I send it. That is, when God releases his word, it's a one-way direction.
Yes.
If God releases word and said, go to California from here, it doesn't concern the word of God whether they are doing marriage ceremony in Illinois and then let me just branch and watch. No, one way. It's going to California.
That's right.
So when I release my word, he said, so shall my word be. So shall my word be. So shall my word be.
Amen.
As rain comes down as snow from heaven to water the earth and does not return thither, but watering the earth, so that it can cause it to bring forth and bore, that it might give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. That is when the word of God comes like rain and snow, it produces effect. Before it goes back, like rain will go back in evaporation. It doesn't take no for an answer. So when the word came to Isaac and said, no, don't go anywhere, so here, there was no rain, it was in famine. And he reaped hundredfold. Because the word cannot go back to God to report that it is because there is no rain. That's why we are not able to produce crop.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
So God gave the word to Apostle Paul. You will get to Rome. Things that are written down are written for our admonition upon whom the end of the world has come.
Yes.
This happened to him. It was instructive to me that the first thing that the devil did was to raise some foolish people. Over 40. And said, we are not going to eat to show their seriousness until we keep Paul. So we have come to you, the high priest, under the captain of the army, to bring Paul again as if you want to examine him for that. And then along the way, we kill him. Do you know what the word of God did? He ensured that
Paul,
Paul's relative, Paul, was around that time and he just hired him and reported the word. That was how they transported Paul that night. Around 9 p.m. To Caesarea.
Yeah.
So before they could come to request, Paul had escaped.
Yes.
Because the word arranged that a small boy, Paul's auntie's child also, was around at that time. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That was the first conflict that the word of God overcame.
Amen.
praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We can read all of those things. I just want to list them because of time. Another thing that we noticed was that the devil raised delay for Paul. He left Jerusalem and was transported to Caesarea that night. But when he got there, Philip was the governor. And he preached before Philip and all of those other people. Philip shake and said, "This is too much. Please take Paul out of here. I will listen to you at a more confident time." So the word of God was bringing him under confession. But he didn't give his life to Jesus. So what he did, thinking that Paul was going to bribe him, was to invite Paul separately. "Come and talk to me. Come and talk to me," for the space of 2 years. We never had that. Felix, I wanted to say, yeah. Governor Felix, not Philip, ever gave his life to Jesus Christ. And he delayed Paul in jail for 2 years. This was somebody God spoke to in Jerusalem. Now, what you just need to, okay, so how many days will it take me from Jerusalem to Rome if you are going by water? That should just have been it, isn't it? So the second thing that came against an assault that came against God's word given to Paul was a delay. He was there for 2 years. And then after 2 years, Governor Felix was replaced by another governor called Festus. As soon as Festus came, he went to Jerusalem too. And the Jews came and said, "There's a man called Paul in Caesarea, your government seat. We want you to bring him to Jerusalem because he did something. Don't forget the initial plan to kill him in ambush." Now, Festus didn't know what happened, but the Spirit of God, the Word of God, gave him the word to say, even without his knowing. He said, "No, I cannot bring Paul to Jerusalem." He didn't know whether they were ambush. He just said, "I'm going back to Caesarea. If you have anything against him, come to Caesarea." That was how the second attempt was followed. The Word of God was underground working. Ensuring that word that Jesus Christ spoke, that he was going to get to Rome, was just working. That was how that one was cancelled. The third ambush was averted by Paul himself in the book of Acts, chapter 25:9-12. Festus listened to him. King Agrippa came and they sat down in the hall, and Paul preached. Then after his word, King Agrippa and Festus, Agrippa said, Festus who was saying, wanting to just do the Jews right. He said, "Okay, would you like to go to Jerusalem to be tried there?" Remember that the Jews requested from him when he was in Jerusalem that they wanted him to bring Paul to Jerusalem to be tried. But they meant to kill him in ambush. And Festus, without knowing that the word of God was working at all, just said, "No, I can't bring you. You come to Caesarea." Now, in order to please them, because those people have come to, he said, "Okay, Paul, we've had everything that you have said. Would you like to?" He was in the place of authority. He was one to say, "Okay, you are going to Jerusalem." He said, "Would you like to?" Paul said, "No, I'm not going to Jerusalem. I stand before Caesar here, represented by the governor. If I have done anything wrong, please judge me here. If you cannot do it here, I appeal to Caesar." That was how Paul averted. He might not even have known at that time when he was saying, "I appeal to Caesar." But the word of God was moving him to Rome anyhow, because Caesar was in Rome at that particular time. So the word of God moved Paul again. Then King Agrippa, when he came, also listened to Paul and said, "This man has not done anything. If he has not appealed to Caesar, I would have said that he should release him." So the word of God went ahead for Paul to have appealed to Caesar before Agrippa came. Otherwise, that chain of movement will have been disrupted. Now, I understand that God will speak sometime. If you are living in the will of God, there are steps you will take that you don't even know, but it's taking you to the point.
Yeah.
It's taking you to the will of God for your life. And there are things around you that people will do that will be taking you, to the point that the Lord wants you to be. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When that has been settled, then they put Paul inside a ship. They used 2 ships to get to Rome. The first was coming from Adramyttium, and they put them there. But what God did, the word of God did, was to have chosen the head of, what do we call them now? Brother Akande, the head of Centurion, let me just call them Centurion. Before I say what I don't know about ministry. So, let's call them Centurion. This guy, God selected him and he was very good. But the sixth thing that we know was that as they entered the ship, contrary wind began to blow. There is a somebody who carried the mandate of God in that ship, who was going to row, and the contrary wind began to blow. It happened to Jesus too. He said to his disciples, let's go to the other side. He joined them and was sleeping by the back of the sun. And wind began to blow. See, these winds, orchestrated by the devil, does not respect whether you are there or not. So it's the word of God that you have had that you will then use to counter the work of the enemy. Mm-hmm. So we see that this wind began to blow. That's Acts 27 and chapter 4. Acts 27 and chapter 4. Anyway, the sailor, they knew how to go about it. They took an alternative route and then they got a second ship. And then they asked Paul and his people to enter the second ship coming from Alexandria. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
As they entered that ship too, another wind started. Mm-hmm. See, sometimes you wonder why it has been cascaded of challenges. One after the other. One after, it might just be because of the word that the Lord has given you. That word is more important to the devil. That's the reason why he probably wants to kill or frustrate you. It's because he believes that once you are dead, the word is gone. He attempted Jesus severally. Because what some of us believe is just that Jesus died on the cross. Go and read about the life of Jesus. You will notice that he was attempted by death several times. By death several times. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
See, I used to think that I love the way and life of Bishop Oyedepo. See, there is a way God patterns somebody ahead of you. This man operates by faith, and that's very wonderful. Nothing has come upon him until one day I didn't know what happened. I just saw one of his message, which he called Thanksgiving or something. And I clicked there and I was listening. That was when I heard that he was involved in an accident when he was younger. And one of his children that are now preaching was just like a 4-year-old boy at that time. He said he didn't even know they were like on 140 kilometers per hour. When he heard, bah! It was the front tire. And he said he has not read anything about don't press, what we call it, brake and things like that. He just happened not to press the brake. Why? Because the devil saw what God has given that servant of God. He said, if that has happened, if he had died, they would just have hung the photograph and said, this is the man God gave the vision. And then another person would have continued. He said he has been on a plane before that one engine just busted. And the car was going to say, told the pilot, okay, turn. And God saved them, they landed safely. So the majority of these people have been attempted by death. Death is the principal instrument of the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Much the same way eternal life is the principal instrument of God.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So we see this, another tempest wind that was more terrible than the previous one that I have said for the second ship. This one, God got across to Paul and said, I see that we should not move at this time. But the sailors and other people, they say, let us move. Let us move. Number one, it is not good to winter here.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, when they saw the southern wind that was blowing softly, whatever the interpretation was to them at that time, it meant that the road will be okay.
Mm.
When that particular wind is blowing. The Bible says the wind began to blow softly. And the majority said, let us go. So they agreed to the advice of the expert. But God was speaking through Paul. Sometimes there are decisions that people take that you can't do anything about, but they will work for your good in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God told Paul, don't move. He told them. He said, no, we are going to move. And by the time they moved, oh my God. The Bible says after they moved, and you see how that's how the devil worked. He knew what they wanted, soft wind. He gave that one. They pushed into the sea. By the time they get into the middle, and they cannot go back to the what we call, is it the bay or beach, wherever he released a very tempest wind. And so they could not correct the ship again. They left the ship to go on. Do you know what happened? That wind was raging, unabated, for 14 days. The Bible says for many days they didn't see the sun, nor the day at all. Nobody ate for 14 days. There was no announcement that they were going to start prayer tomorrow. It just started. And they were throwing, see, the devil said something that was correct. He said, whatsoever a man has, that shall he give for his life. They threw everything in the sea in an attempt to save their own life. They threw the equipment of the ship in the sea. They threw wheat in the ship. Now, Luke, who was writing this account, said that after so many days, all hope that we should be saved was lost. Sometimes we feel like that though God has spoken to us, but because of the repeated bashings, we lose hope on what God has said. At the point that Paul was to give up, God sent an angel. He said, be of good cheer, do not fear, you must appear before Caesar. That was what God, Jesus told him in Jerusalem. And so they were going, they had a shipwreck. All of them were saved. But as soon as they got to a particular island whose name they knew later, 276 people were in that ship. Three were reported to be Christian. The person who was writing, that's Dr. Luke, Jesus, and one Aristarchus of Macedonia. Three of them. When they got to the island, it was cold. Now, of all people, 276 people, Paul was gathering stick to make fire. And it was only Paul that the snake came to. And was beaten by snake. I mean, it's very clear to see that the devil didn't want him to get home.
Yes.
God encouraged him, you will get to Caesar. So it's faith. This accounts for the reason why sometimes when you are weary, God gives you a fresh revelation.
Yes.
Upon the one that he had given before. You got weary now because something happened, and then as you are doing this, you just come across maybe a devotional that speaks to you directly. Then your faith is energized, and then you continue to go again. That was what happened to Paul. So we see, and they continue like that, until they got to Rome. In the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapter 28 and verse 16. Paul started that journey took close to 2.5 years. What was just simply spoken to, and Jesus understood all of those, but he didn't give him detail. No, God gives us the word without the detail. I do not know what you are passing through as you are watching us online, but what you should strive for now is that God should give you word for that particular situation.
Amen.
It is the same thing whether you are trusting God to have children, you're trusting God to get married, you're trusting God for admission, you are trusting God for the fulfillment of your ministry. It's the same pattern. Get hold of the word of God. Know that the word of God has integrity. It cannot fail, it cannot change, it cannot be opposed. It is pure.
Amen.
And understand, there are so many people in the Bible who have gone through what you are going through now. When you do that, you will also get to your home. Let's rise up.
Amen.
I want us to pray for ourselves. Tell God that you appreciate him. You know, we may be at different points in life. Tell him that you appreciate him for the word he spoke to you some time ago. Appreciate him. Tell him that you now know that no matter the conflict,
no matter the opposition,